Good morning and happy Easter. We're going to sing one favorite, one of the wonderful Easter songs that we're not singing during the service, and this will also be your prelude. So, Crown Him with Many Crowns is on page 327 in your hymnal, or it's up on the screen. Number 327, let's stand together, please, and sing this as our prelude this morning. Crown Him with Many Crowns. You may be seated.
Good morning.
Happy Easter.
God is good. And all the time.
Right.
What a blessing it is to be in the house of the Lord here on this Easter morn. I just pray that you feel God's presence, God's love. We've all been made in the image of the Lord. And he desires to be in a relationship with each and every one of us that is real, that is personal. And I pray that you feel God's presence today. At this time, I'm going to ask if there's any announcements. Are there any announcements today?
Happy Easter. And first of all, I would like to thank everyone for all the prayers and the cards and the food and the calls and the messages. It goes on and on and on. Thank you. And then I want to let you know I will be starting a maintenance therapy on Tuesday. And again, I want to thank you for your prayers.
Okay. Thank you, Judy, so much. We just want to give God a big hand clap, you know? Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Yes.
A couple of things. I just want to give a big shout out to Nancy and Dave for all their help they did in helping organize Holy Week and for everyone's help in making it happen. So it was wonderful, and I'm so blessed to end it today on Easter Sunday. Also, Cancer Walk is coming up, so if you're interested on doing anything for Cancer Walk team, hit me up.
All right. Yeah, I want to thank everyone. It was such a blessing to see this church, this community come together, and it was a wonderful Holy Week. And many of us probably thinking, kind of like Jesus, can't wait to get this Holy Week over with. But what a blessing it was. And all right, and Deb has an announcement, and...
Remember Wednesday, 6:30, circle group, down in the basement. We're cleaning the kitchen. And anybody else that wants to come help, whoa, that would be awesome. I know the youth are going to help us. But, you know, anybody else that wants to come down at 6:30 and join in, thanks.
Okay. All right. Are there any other announcements?
Yes. Mark's having a birthday today.
Oh, wow.
I think he's turning 27.
All right. Well, on this Easter morn, you want to start us off with happy birthday. I'll walk away from the mic. You want to help us, Anita?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Mark. Happy birthday to you.
Well, God bless you. God bless you. And thank you all. And you know, I'm just reflecting on this past week, and it was such a blessing. And Jeff had wonderful messages, and it was, like I said, it was my first time and to witness it and to go through it, and it was a blessing. And I know I was blessed because of it. Are there any prayer concerns, any joys, any concerns? If you look at your bulletin, next week, starting at 2 o'clock, we'll meet at the church, and we're going to have a prayer walk. And I think we're going to have some from the Nazarene Church is going to go with us too. So we're going to walk the community. We're going to start walking and praying it. We won't get it all done in 1 hour this next week. But what a blessing. And if other churches want to join us, that'll be such a blessing that we lift up our community in prayer. And that God will just work in a mighty way. And I am praying for revival for community, but we know that revival starts within. And as you can see, we have quite a bit going on throughout the week, so please check that out. Also, the Easter lilies given in loving memory. The church just looks beautiful, and thank you all very much. Are there any others? Are there any others? Okay. Well, if not, let's take a little time and greet one another.
Would you tell good people
God loves you and there's nothing you can do about it? All right.
To God forever and ever. Christ is risen.
Hallelujah.
Let us pray. Well, gracious God, we thank you and praise you because you have risen. You are seated at the right hand of Father Almighty. And you tell us to bring all prayers to you. We just thank you and praise you on this Easter morn. When people can stand up and talk about just all the outpouring of love and the cards and the concern and the prayers. Dear Lord, we just pray for Judy. Just continually heal her, dear Lord. Continually to minister to her and Jerry. Dear Lord, we thank you for Mark's birthday. And dear Lord, for the opportunity to have birthday on an Easter Sunday. What a blessing. Dear Lord, we thank you for this past week, Holy Week. Dear Lord, there were so many that came out and so many heard your word and just wonderful fellowship and the koinonia, dear Lord. I just thank you and praise you for all of it. Because, dear Lord, the focus was on you, dear Jesus. You're the reason, dear Lord, and we thank you and praise you because you defeated the great enemies of sin, Satan, and death. And we thank you and praise you for our great Redeemer. Gracious God, just continually to minister to each and every heart. We thank you for this Easter Sunday. We thank you again to be able to worship you and praise you, knowing that we are loved, knowing that we're forgiven, knowing that you'll never leave nor forsake, that we can always count on you. You never out-promise. You're the original promise keeper. We thank you and praise you. Now, gracious God, we come to you in a prayer that Jesus taught the disciples. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Now at this time we'll be singing Christ the Lord is Risen Today. You'll find that on page 302 of your hymnal or on the screen.
Oh,
may be seated. And at this time is the time for young disciples. And Susan has a message for you.
So earlier this week, I was in the room and I was preparing for this Young Disciples time with you, and Faith came into the room and she asked me what I was doing, and I said I was practicing the Easter story using resurrection eggs. And Faith, what did you say to me?
I said, Mom, you told me that story so many times that I could do it. Mom, what did you say?
Okay, smarty pants, you can just do it.
My mom always told me with 12 resurrection eggs, but today I'll be telling you with 6 resurrection eggs. So egg number one, Rex, can you open egg number one? What did you find inside? The breadcrumb reminds us that Jesus ate dinner with his friends.
Luke chapter 22, verses 14 and 15 says, "When the hour came, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table, and he said to them, 'I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer.'"
Lexi, will you open egg number two? What did you find inside? The cross reminds us that the next day, Jesus died on the cross for us.
John chapter 19, verses 17 and 18. Carrying his own cross, he went out to the place of the skull. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on each side and Jesus in the middle.
Brooke, can you open egg number three? What did you find inside? The piece of cloth reminds us that Jesus was wrapped in cloth and placed in the tomb.
John chapter 19, verse 40. Taking Jesus' body, the two of them wrapped it with the spices and strips of linen.
Remy, do you open number four? What did you find?
A rock.
The rock reminds us that a stone was placed in front of the tomb.
Matthew chapter 27, verses 59 and 60. Jesus took the body, wrapped it in a clean linen cloth, and placed it in his own new tomb that he had cut out of the rock. He rolled a big stone in front of the entrance to the tomb and went away.
Riley, open number five. What did you find? The empty egg reminds us of Jesus' friends came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been moved away. The tomb was empty.
Luke chapter 24, verses 1 through 3. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the woman took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus.
Hadley, you're going to open egg number 6. What did you find? The M&Ms reminds us of the sweet surprise of Easter that Jesus is alive.
Matthew chapter 28, verses 5 and 6. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He is risen. Just as he said, come and see the place where he lay."
Okay, let's review. Egg number 1 had the breadcrumb. What did that remind us of? It reminds us that Jesus ate dinner with his friends. Egg number 2 had the cross. And what did that remind us of? That Jesus died on the cross for us. Egg number 3 had the piece of cloth. What did that remind us of? Yeah, that Jesus was wrapped in a cloth and placed in a tomb. Egg number 4 had the rock. What did that remind us of? The stone was placed in front of the tomb. Egg number 5 had the empty egg. What did that remind us of? That when Jesus' friends came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been moved away, the tomb was empty. And egg number 6 had the M&Ms. And what did that remind us of? Yeah, the sweet surprise of Easter, that Jesus is alive.
Let's say a little prayer. And you can repeat after me. Dear Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross for me.
Thank you for dying on the cross for me.
Help me share the Easter story with others.
Help me share the Easter story with others.
Happy Easter, Jesus.
Happy Easter, Jesus.
And all God's children said,
Amen.
Okay, so my challenge to you guys is to go home and tell 5 different people about the Easter story, and then you can get an M&M, and then you share an M&M with the person.
Now we'll be blessed with her choir anthem, Alleluia, Jesus is King. And now we'll be singing Up From the Grave Heroes, number 322 in your hymnal. This time is a time as we receive our offerings. I'm going to have the ushers come forward. It's always a blessing to be in ministry with God. So at this time, let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you and praise you on this Easter morning because we serve a risen Lord that defeated sin and death. We thank you and praise you for this opportunity as we give today. We ask that you would bless this offering because, dear Lord, we know that all good things come from heaven above. And we know as you bless this offering, it'll further the kingdom here in Ellsworth and throughout the world, that people would hear the good news. Maybe for some, it may be the first time. Not only is good news, it is great news of Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. He is seated at the right hand of Father Almighty. And dear Lord, we just thank you again. Not only you bless this offering, but you're blessing each and every one that is able to give, not only financially, but of time and service, prayer and presence. So just minister to each and every heart, because, dear Lord, we are in ministry with you. We thank you and praise you. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen.
Matthew 28, verses 1 to 10. In the Pew Bible, New Testament verse, New Testament page number 41. After the Sabbath, as the first day of the week was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord, descending from heaven, came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. For fear of him, the guards shook and became like dead men. But the angel said to the woman, "Do not be afraid. I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has been raised, as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he has been raised from the dead, And indeed, he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him. This is the message for you. Excuse me. So they left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly, Jesus met them and said greetings, and they came to him, took hold of his feet, and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Pat. Before I go to prayer, I just listening as the offering was being received. We are so blessed with wonderful musicians. We're just so blessed. This church is so blessed, and so many great people, like all of you. And what a blessing it is to be here on this Easter Sunday. And at this time, I would like for you to bow your heads with me as I pray. Gracious God, we thank you and praise you for this day. Dear Lord, here on Easter Sunday, as we reflect and hold on to who you are and what you have done. Dear Jesus, you have defeated the great enemy of sin, of Satan, and death. And dear Lord, we just thank you and praise you because you are the greatest overcomer of all. So I just ask that you would give me the words today, that they'd be your words and not mine. Because your words never return void. So dear Lord, just draw us closer that we'd have a greater understanding of your interpretation and application of your word for our lives here today. We thank you and praise you in Jesus' precious name. Amen and amen. Well, it's been about a year. Actually, it was on April the 22nd, 2018, that James Shaw Jr. was sitting with a friend in a Waffle House at the counter in Nashville, Tennessee, when a gunman wearing only a green jacket opened fire. Shaw bolted from his seat and slid along the ground as he looked for the gunman. When the shooter paused to reload, when he was starting to put the next magazine into his assault rifle, Shaw rushed him. He said, "I acted in a blink of a second." Shaw said when he reloaded his clip, he wasn't looking at me, he was looking down. But he said it felt like that took 30 minutes for him to reload his clip. He said, "I could hear a voice say, 'Do it now, go now.' So I just took off and I started wrestling the gun away from him, and the gun actually was thrown over the counter and then he rushed out. Four lives were lost that tragic Sunday, and four lives were injured. But the authorities said that he was a hero. He saved so many lives. And this electrician of age 29, James Shaw Jr., says, "Don't call me a hero. Just call me James." He said, "Because what I was doing, I was just thinking about save myself. I wasn't even thinking of my four-year-old daughter. I was just thinking about saving myself." And you know, we're all hardwired that way. We're hardwired to save ourselves. And how important life is. The greatest overcomer of all is Jesus. About a month and a half ago, I started telling you about one of my favorite overcomers of the Old Testament, and that was David. When he was a teenager, probably only 5 foot tall, was taking on Goliath that was 9 foot and 9 inches tall. Taking on this great warrior. But he knew it was God's war. He knew it was God's battle. Just as God had taken care of him before, when he took on the lions, when he took on the Bears. This draft is next Thursday. NFL, he wasn't afraid of the Giants. Okay, I knew I'd get it out one more time. It is, truly, the NFL draft. I know all of you know that, probably. Betty can hardly keep me away from the TV because of it. But anyway, Jesus is the greatest overcomer of all. Through his death, burial, and resurrection, he overcame the greatest enemies, sin, Satan, and death. He overcame these enemies personally. He overcame them powerfully. And the most importantly, he overcame them permanently. It's done. It is done. This is the greatest message of the gospel. How simple it is to understand. It's a single sentence, and actually it's on a frisbee. Isn't that right? From Romans 6:23. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. The gift of God is not ordinary, though. This may be simple, but it costs greatly. But it is free for all. All we have to do is to believe, to repent, turn back to God, and accept what Jesus Christ has done for us. He died on the cross, and he arose in 3 days. So that we can be overcomers. Ben Patterson, author of the book, Deepening Your Conversation with God. He was writing about a primitive tribe in the jungles of East Africa who knew nothing of the gospel and feared death. Now, many of us have probably heard of the gospel maybe 50, 100 times. But these people had never heard of the gospel. And they were watching a movie, and they'd never seen a movie. The missionary brought them the movie Jesus, the one that had been translated more than any movie ever. It was about the life of Jesus, according to the book of Luke. So he started on this film, and they were watching it, and the thing is, this has been translated to even their own language. And they're hearing Jesus and watching Jesus love people, watching Jesus heal people, watching Jesus take care of people. They was enthralled. This was just wonderful. And then the movie started to shift. Jesus was arrested and was given to the Roman soldiers. And they all got upset. And then they thought, this must have been the missionaries doing. And he had to shut off the film. He said, no, this movie isn't over. This isn't how it ends. Please watch. It is so great. You have to watch the whole movie to understand this good news. So he turned it on again, and now they saw Jesus being crucified and how terrible it was, and they were crying, and then they saw where he actually died, and these are people that are afraid of death. And they just almost couldn't take any more, and he had to shut it off, and they were so emotional. He said, it isn't over. The best is yet to come. It is not over. So then he turns the movie back on, and it finishes as Jesus walks out of an empty tomb, how he has defeated death, and they start yelling and applauding, and actually I'm about ready to do the same thing, even though I've heard it over and over again. What a blessing. Death could not hold him. Death could not hold him because it is unbearable weight, the fear of death. There are many people that are, even billionaires, are trying to escape death. There is one that's called cryogenics. It's a process of freezing oneself in a vat of liquid nitrogen at the exact moment just before you die, and that you will be brought back later on in life. Now, this sounds far-fetched, and you know that guy in the suspenders, what's his name? Larry King. Larry King always ask people about how they feel about death. Larry King is one of the 300, well, wait, there's 350 people that have already done this. Larry King hasn't done this yet. He's still alive. I saw him on an infomercial just yesterday morning, real early. Is on vitamins, but but anyway, Larry King is one of the 2,000 people that have signed up for this. He said, you know, they're a little bit nuts, but he says, you know, it gives us a little hope. There is something that gives us so much greater hope, so much greater hope. But before there can be a resurrection, there must be a death. And the Roman soldiers knew exactly what was going on that Good Friday with Jesus on the cross. For 6 hours, he was on that cross. And how they would breathe, they would have to raise up to get that air. And it was almost the Sabbath. It was almost Friday at dusk. And in Jerusalem, even though it was outside of Jerusalem, they wouldn't allow someone to hang from the cross on the Sabbath. So what they would do, they would actually break the bones, but they didn't on Jesus because he was already dead. To even make sure, they even ran a spear through his ribs, through the pericarp of his heart. But Psalm 34:20 tells us not a bone was broken. You see, they would break the bones. They'd hit them right at the knee so they couldn't raise up to breathe. They didn't need to do that. Jesus had already passed. The central doctrine, yes, the cross is so important because Jesus died for our sins. But he even went farther than just dying for sins. He also defeated death. Just as he said, in 3 days he arose. He arose. So I want us to look at the realities of overcoming death. The seven S's, if you would. I would have spelled it out, but Deanna wouldn't have any room on the... Yeah, I can see her face. She wouldn't have had room in the bulletin, and we have to have a bulletin because that's how we worship, is from the bulletin. Next week we'll have more amens in it. But anyway, of the seven S's, the first one is the soldiers. They were Roman guards. There would have been 16 of them that would be stationed at the tomb. Four of them on duty. The other were in a semicircle asleep. So if anyone was going to go to the tomb, they'd have to go through 16 Roman soldiers, 12 of them sleeping, 4 of them awake. They were taught to take on an area of 6 feet around them in hand-to-hand combat. There wasn't anyone better in that day. But we know the greatest spin of all. They said that Jesus was stolen. There was no way those common fishermen could have taken on those 16 Roman guards. But that was the spin. See, politics hadn't changed that much. There was spinning back then. Another S, the seal. In Matthew 27, they say there was, over the tomb, over that stone, was a cord that was on that they, on each side, was a wax seal with the insignia of the Roman government. So if you broke that seal, you would have the Roman government after you also. The third was the stone. It's actually quite large. It would weigh about 2 tons. 4,000 pounds. No wonder the women wondered as they were walking early that morning, who's going to move away that stone? Who's going to move that stone? That's more than a small car, 4,000 pounds. And actually that stone, the way there's a groove that is cut out and they have a wedge, and then when they're ready to set the stone, they pull out that wedge and it rolls and slams shut. 4,000 pounds. The next S would be the sepulcher. It was empty. And as Apostle Paul said, it was not done in a corner. Everyone knew about it. You could all go and see that tomb was empty. I know we have a few volunteer firemen here and a few police officers. They don't really chase the police officers, but many times when there's a fire, have you noticed you have more people than is on the fire department? Yeah? Okay. Can you imagine after hearing about Jesus, the resurrection, that tomb was actually empty? It was like he said it would be. Can you imagine all the people that were willing to go see that, to see for themselves? We know in Luke, on the walk to Emmaus, when Cleopas is talking to Jesus, and he said, and the women found the tomb empty, and sure enough, because there's many witnesses to went to look for themselves, to see that empty tomb. See that empty tomb. But the tomb wasn't totally empty. There was, for the other S would be the shroud. For the fifth S would be the shroud. It was the grave clothes still in the tomb, slightly indented like an empty chrysalis of a caterpillar cocoon. Jesus came through those grave clothes. When Mary told Peter and John that someone had taken our Lord, they went running as fast as they could. And they stopped and looked and stared and saw those grave clothes. And then the wrapping on the head was actually also folded. And when I think about that, you know, Jesus was once a carpenter. And they said, when you did the work and it was done and completed, and to pass the inspection, they would take a rag and wipe around to make sure that all the edges were smooth, that everything was done, complete, and then they would fold and put the rag on the work. That rag was on that stone, was in that tomb. It was completed. It was done. Then the scars. For the sixth one is the scars. In John 20, 20 through 28. So the other disciples told him, and they're talking to Thomas, because Thomas wasn't with them that first night, that Sunday night when Jesus walked through the locked doors. We have seen the Lord. But he said to them, this is Thomas, unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my fingers where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe it. And a week later, as the disciples were in the house again and Thomas was with them, though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. Then he said to Thomas, put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. And stop unbelieving. Stop doubting and believe. And Thomas said to him, my Lord, my God. And then the sightings. The seven S would be the sighting. The resurrected Lord from Luke in Acts 1:3 said this. After his sufferings, he showed himself to these men and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. For 40 days, he appeared to them. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 3 through 6, for what I received, I pass on to you as of first importance. That Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. That he was buried and that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures. That he appeared to Peter and to the 12. And after that he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers and sisters at the same time. Most of whom are still living. Though some have fallen asleep. when Apostle Paul wrote this, there were many witnesses still alive that could tell them about being with the risen Lord, about being with the risen Lord. Like I said, this is a cornerstone of our faith, the result of a living, overcoming death. Since he lives, we can also live. We live also. It's a time to live as an overcomer. Jesus has authority to give life both eternally and abundantly. I want to look at four profound, highly practical implications because he lives. Because he lived, you can live a forgiven life. Because Jesus lived, you can live a forgiven life. And Deuteronomy 23:5 tells us that he turned the curse into a blessing for you. All your sins have been forgiven. Your sins, your mistakes have been forgiven. The Lord can work good in all things. You are redeemed. All your sins have been paid for. God has forgiven you. But you know, many times I talk to people and they say, well, I know God, Jesus has forgiven me, but I can't forgive myself. You know, nowhere in the Bible does it say that we must forgive ourselves. And let's be honest. If we're putting ourselves before God, that's kind of not really a good territory, is it? Remember, you have been forgiven by God Almighty. So live as forgiven people. Because he is risen, you can have a meaningful life. In 1 Corinthians 58, therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourself fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. Go ahead and labor, because it's not in vain. Because we have a risen Lord. We can have a meaningful life. I had the opportunity to be on the board of ordained ministry and on the conference level and also on the district level. And board of ordained ministry doesn't just mean boom, but what it also means is you have the opportunity to watch people and help people, shepherd people as they go through the journey of becoming ordained. I had the opportunity to talk to a young lady that has graduated from Asbury Seminary. Right now she's in Great Bend Trinity, but she'll be going to Michigan to be closer to her family and her husband's family. But she started sharing with me because I was asking her about her faith. And she said, you know, it started when I was 12 years old. She said, I was an athlete and I was running for Junior Olympics. My sister and I, and we're from Michigan where we've already competed and we're coming back through the state of Ohio, and there's this great service station, this great big large station that they went in. And have you ever seen those machines where you put two quarters and a penny and you push it in and then and it rolls it and then stamps something on the penny? Well, that's what she did. And here she is 12 years old, and she's trying to figure out what was on this penny, and her mom and dad are driving, and her sister's in the back seat with her. And she says, I don't understand this, Our Father. What is this saying? And the parent says, well, girls, that's a prayer that Jesus taught the disciples. And they said, well, who's Jesus? Well, long time ago, he was Jewish, and he came and died for our mistakes. And she looked at her 10-year-old sister, and they look at each other and said, you guys knew this and you didn't tell us? We want to go to church. And they started going to church, and this is the part that I really like. And I know this is Easter, and that's why we're full. But what was really interesting to me, she said, for the first 6 weeks, we had to sit in the back, because that must be where you start when you first begin. And as we was in church longer, we got to move farther and farther up front. true story. Like I said, you can ask her. I got her name. Her name is Stephanie Norton. But, you know, we need to tell someone. We talked about this before. We need to be microphones to tell others and how meaningful one's life is when one receives that forgiveness and that we can live in a way that makes a difference in a broken and a hurting world. Because he is risen, you can live a powerful life. In Ephesians chapter 1, verses 18 and 20, this was some that Jeff told us to read. He says, I pray also that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and his incomparable great power for us who believe. That power is like the working of his mighty strength, which he exerted in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly realms. You can have a life of a powerful life because the Lord has risen. You can have a powerful life. Think of that. The same power that raised Jesus from the dead is the power that you have to take on any adversity, any problem, because you know the Lord is with you. You know the Lord will never leave you nor forsake you. In her prayer time in Kannapolis, Betty spoke up and said, I have a praise. Because 15 years ago, the next day after Easter, I had surgery. The cancer was removed. I remember reading that scripture in John when the women were walking to the tomb and it was dark. I have to admit, it was dark for me on that Easter Sunday. But I knew it wasn't total darkness because we serve a risen Lord that gives us the power to march on each and every day. Because he is risen, you can live a never-ending life. In 1 Corinthians 15:20, but Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. These first fruits, this is Jesus, is our down payment. He has made the payment for us. And this is Jesus speaking to Martha after her brother has been dead for 4 days. And he tells her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? Do you believe this? You know, I believe this, and my prayer is that you've also received that forgiveness. My prayer is that you have received Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. He's paid the price, but we have to repent. We have to receive it. And the life that we can have is immeasurable. It is so great. That is why the stone is moved away. Jesus walked through that, but that stone is moved away so you and I can see that empty tomb. And it's still empty today. Let us pray. Gracious God, we just thank you and praise you that we serve a risen Lord. We thank you for Easter and that we would live as Easter people. People that have a Lord that is risen, that gives us abundant life and eternal life. We thank you and praise you again. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. Now at this time, if you're comfortable standing, I'm going to ask if you would please stand as we sing our final hymn, He Lives, found on page 310 or on the screen.
Thank you.
before I send you out with a benediction, I have an announcement. All kids, young and old, I guess that's all of us, are invited to an Easter egg hunt in front of the church. So you're all invited to Easter egg hunt in front of the church. Well, gracious God, we thank you and praise you on this Easter morning, knowing that we have a risen Lord, and he does live in our hearts. And dear Lord, what a blessing it is to share the hope that we have that is available to all. We thank you again for your grace. I send them out in your power. Power of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. Happy Easter.